sometimes songs bring back some memories, and one that I think my wife will probably remember fairly well is one time we were in a congregation, and we had just, we were singing the song that we had just sang, and the song leader, whenever it came time for us to sing Stand in Awe of You, he assumed everybody should just stand up at that part. And I've seen that done where people are like, well, you know, they lead the song and they kind of do like this and everybody stands up and, you know, to each their own on that one. I don't see anything right or wrong, but he was so adamant about that and didn't give any warning that that's what he wanted everybody to do. And while everybody sat down through that part, he then stopped the song and started yelling at the congregation, stand up, you know, and he was so mad, and one of the elders, just spoke up and said, "We're not going to do that. we're not standing up right now, you know." And it was just because of how adamant he was, and he got upset, and he came to me, beelined it for me afterwards, and I said, "Brother, if you want people to do that, you need to let us know. But just because the song says that doesn't mean that we need to do it. Matter of fact, that's more of a state of being than anything, being in awe of something, not actually literally standing." And I said, you know, if we were really going to think about that, then what do we do when we sing the song and we say, "I stand to praise you, but I fall to my knees." So, like, we can't just take everything quite literally when it comes to those things. There is definitely a poetic nature when it comes to songs, but I think I'll remember that one for quite a while. I hope you remember that one, too, because it's pretty funny. But in the end, when we're looking at songs, you know, we need to be reverent while we're doing that, while we're singing. And if we're going to give specific instruction, that needs to be done right at the beginning, right? But I appreciate Brother Jeff and his ability in leading songs, and thank you for the good memory. That was fun. A week from today, I will not be here. I'll still be at a lectureship in Branson, Missouri. And I'll be preaching over there, and I'm going to preach part of what I'm going to preach over there because, you know, technically speaking, whenever I like to, when I go to the lectureship and preach, and, you know, and I've been asked to preach on something specific, or, you know, whenever I've given a topic and think that that's good, I like to kind of have a little precursor to it and let the congregation hear some of it, but I like to give the full version whenever I'm there just because I feel like that's what... That's what I'm going for, is that I'm preaching a sermon. So we're going to have part of that lesson. And I'm going to tell you this, that for those that have never been to a lectureship, it's a good experience because when you have like a gospel meeting, gospel meetings are, you know, really to try to bring people in and have basic messages. But then when you go to a lectureship is for brethren, you know. Yeah, you could invite somebody, but it's for brethren. It's to get deeper into the Word of God. And so I hope that you take the time to do that someday. We're going to go and we're going to hear Brother B.J. Clark again, and we're going to hear Don Blackwell. They'll both be there, and there's going to be several other great preachers that we're going to be able to sit at the feet of. And then I'll also preach, but... And if you want to, I believe all of those are going to be streamed live. If you look at the Branson Church of Christ, there'll be a lectureship schedule, and you can go online. They're on Central Time, so you'll have to go back an hour in your mind. But you have that opportunity if you want to go ahead and look at that. Now, one of the things that... The thing I'm going to be talking about is the need for basic Bible preaching. And the very first thing that we need to consider when thinking about basic Bible preaching, and that the very first thought is, well, you know, the Bible has to be true, right? You have to think the Bible is true and that you can follow it only. Now, that seems like that's an easy concept, but the religious world has a really tough time with that one. And, you know, if you look at it, if you were to look at some of these religious cults out there, I think mainly about the Mormon church, you know, they do use the King James Version of the Bible, but they really use it seldom because they have other books. They have Doctrines and Covenants, Pearl of Great Price. They have their Book of Mormon, of course. And those things are what they use, and they use those on a regular basis. Now, if you were to go and look at lots of, you know, other religious groups, they have their own creed books. I was talking to somebody one time, a long time ago, and I had to dig this out of my library just to prove it to them, but they were a part of, I believe it was, the Baptist church, and they said, you know what? Well, that's why I'm a Baptist, because we don't believe in creeds. And I said, the Baptist church has a creed book. And they said, no, it doesn't. I said, yeah, it sure does. And they were just flabbergasted. They're like, no, I won't. So I had to go to my office, and I grabbed this book, and I brought it back and showed it to them, and they were just in awe. Had no clue that that's what was being taught. Now, if you go to any denomination, you know, probably a grand majority of them are going to have some sort of a creed book. But is that necessary for us? And if we are going to be New Testament Christians, do we need a creed book? Well, no, we don't, because we have the all-sufficiency of the Scriptures. We have something that is far better than a creed book made up by man. We have a book that's from God. Matter of fact, if everybody would just follow that book, everything would be all right in the religious world, right? In 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 10, we see that Paul was writing them saying, look, I beseech you, brethren, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you. And so we are to speak the same thing, but how in the world do we do that? Well, we do that by following the Word of God. In Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, it says this, God, having of old time spoken unto the fathers and the prophets by diverse portions and in diverse manners, hath at the end of these days spoken unto us in His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, through whom also He made the worlds. And so, in the beginning, you had all these different ways in which God would speak to people. You know, it was not every day that you had somebody like Moses, where God spoke directly to Moses. No, He would do this in dreams for some, and He had the prophets, and He'd tell them things, but they were to just repeat the things that they heard. But in these last days, He's spoken unto us by His Son. And so His Son, it's Jesus Christ, He is the one that determines all the things that we should say or do. And how do I know that? Well, Matthew 28 and verse 18, that Jesus has all authority in heaven and on earth. Now, of course, too, if you stay in the book of Hebrews and you go over to Hebrews chapter 9, and you look at verses 15 through 17, it says, and for this cause He is the mediator of a new covenant, that a death having taken place for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first covenant, they that have been called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. For where a testament is, there must of necessity be the death of him that made it. For a testament is a force where there hath been death, for it doth never avail while he that made it liveth. You know, oftentimes people will go to a lawyer, and they will have a will made up for them. And on that will, at the very top, it will say, the last will and what? Testament. When you look at a testament, and we see the New Testament and the Old Testament, we have to think of it just like a will. In the Old Testament, this is God's will moving forward to establish the New Testament, which is Christ's will as well, right? It's God and Christ together. And so then what we see is we have, have a new will, a new covenant, a new testament in which we need to follow. But brethren, that testament only came into being once Jesus died. I remember watching a debate several years ago, back when Harding University was a strong, or at least a stronger, Christian college. And I remember seeing that this this debate about baptism and these I can't remember what denomination these other people were from, but they were talking about the thief on the cross. Well, I want to be saved like the thief on the cross. And they said, you know, that was said before, you know, the New Testament. And so, you know, if you're looking at the thief on the cross is not under the New Testament. He's like, are you kidding me? This is written in the New Testament. And he goes, well, the New Testament is not a force. How in the world do you know that it's not a force? And he says, well, you know what? Jesus had to die. And he brought up this passage. And the guy was really upset about that. And he came back and he was, for some reason, he just wasn't thinking. And he was like, well, how do you know that hadn't died? And it was like, what in the world? Are you kidding me? You know, look back at this and he said, well, you know, Jesus spoke those words. You know, today you will be with me in paradise. And after that fact, he died and the new covenant is in effect. They go and they have to break the legs of those thieves because what? They're still alive. And Jesus had just died. So they died. And the new covenant has just been set up. Jesus promised that to that thief before the new covenant. We have to remember that when we're looking at the Word of God, we need to take it as it is. We need to look at it specifically. We need to follow it to the T. And we need to understand that, yes, Jesus, He is the one that we need to follow today. It is His Word, according to Hebrews chapter 1, that today it's spoken by His Son. And so now we have the new covenant. We are under a new covenant system. And that system was set up by Christ. Look at John chapter 14 with me. John chapter 14. Look at verse 26. It says, but the Comforter, even the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said unto you. And so what is it that we have today? After Jesus was going to die, he said the Holy Spirit's going to come. He is the Comforter. The Comforter is going to come. And he is going to... What? What was that? Look again. He's going to teach you all things. That's a really small word, right? A-L-L, all. But, you know, what does that mean? Is he going to teach you some things and we need to fill in the gaps? No, right? He's going to teach you all things, everything, all things. How much is all? All is all-encompassing, right? It's everything. You know, is he going to leave anything out? No, he's going to teach you all things. Is it going to be partial? No, not at all, because it is going to be everything that they need. And that is passed on to us. Everything that we need is right here in the Word of God. We don't need anything else. We need this right here. It boggles my mind. How many people... I've watched this on TV... I've seen brethren do this to some degree, where they get up and they go on and on and on, and they don't really mention the Word of God. I was just perplexed, I guess about a year ago, I listened to a lesson from a brother in Christ, supposedly, and he taught this entire lesson. And I've only said this once, okay? I can't even think that I've ever said this about a denominational person, okay? But I listened to that entire lesson and I said, he did not, in his commentary of anything. Now, he had a couple of verses of scripture in there, only a couple, didn't have much there. But outside of the passages of scripture that he mentioned, he said absolutely nothing right. Absolutely nothing. The entire lesson, it was like a train wreck. That's what, you know what happens with a train wreck? You know, you don't want to look at it. It's devastating, but what can you not help but do? You can't help but stare. And that's the way I felt during this thing. I thought, I cannot, but surely there's going to be something here that lets us know. Oh no, there wasn't. There wasn't at all. You know why? Because he did not hold fast to the scriptures. And he did not understand the scriptures that he mentioned. Brethren, we have all truth. We need to use it. We need to use this book. If you're there in John, still look at John chapter 16 with me. John 16 and verse 12. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he shall guide you into what? Here it is again. All the truth. For he shall not speak from himself, but what things soever he shall hear, these shall he speak, and he shall declare unto you the things that are to come. And so is the Spirit speaking of himself? No, he's speaking of the things that he is being told to speak from the Father, and those things are coming down and being told to us, and they're told plainly, right? But it is everything. And so, according to John chapter 14 and John chapter 16, do we have all truth? Yes. We have all truth, and we need to follow it. Now, I know this is probably a familiar passage, but if you would, turn over to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, and let's look at chapter 3 and verse 16 and 17 also. It says, every scripture inspired of God is also profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for instruction, which is in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, furnished completely unto every good work. Now, you know, if you're using the King James Version, you're going to see the word perfect there. You want to be perfect? The idea is complete. Sometimes people will think about the idea of perfect and they'll take it outside of the scriptures when applying it to the scriptures. They'll take that word out of the scripture and they think, well, when I think of something perfect, I mean that it's flawless. I talked to a carpenter one time, and I know that we have a couple of carpenters with us, but this carpenter said, you know, I have built a lot of things. And he said, I've got a lot of good tools and I've got a lot of good forms that I can just build things around really quickly. He said, but you know what? There is not a perfect square ever in a house. Not a perfect square. He said, I've got a square, a speed square, and I can make really good, accurate measures. But if I really were to get down to it, there's not a perfect square because it's going to be off just a little. I'm going to cut it just slightly wrong, or it's going to be measured just slightly wrong. And the naked eye may never see it. They may never understand it, but there is not a perfect square. And I tell you what, having worked on houses, I can attest to that. You know, there is oftentimes you go and you put something in a corner and you want it to fit and you may cut it as precisely as you can, and you stick it over in that corner, and guess what? And it's not a perfect fit. Now, when we think of the word perfect, we don't need to think of it in that idea of it being flawless. Like there's just no error at all in it. But what we're talking about when we see perfect right here, we're talking about something being complete. It's put together. It's all together. And you might think of that in the sense that, look, if you're going to build something, sometimes we'll get the kids and we'll, you know, put a puzzle together. You know, you'll put, like I remember us putting together a little model car one time on Father's Day. And you do something like that. And when you're all done, guess what? It's complete. And there may be a scratch on the surface of the puzzle, but it's complete. You know, but when you're looking at this, if you want to be complete in Christ, then you have to do these things. Every scripture inspired of God is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for instruction, which is in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete. And then furnished completely unto every good work. Got to think also about another passage here when we're thinking about how the Word of God, not only is it inspired of God, it helps us to be complete. It is perfect. It is entire. But look, in verse 3 of Jude, it says this. It says, "Beloved, while I was giving all diligence to write unto you of your common salvation, I was constrained to write unto you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered unto the saints." It was delivered. All of it was delivered. It was delivered for everyone. And so all this is done so that we know that we have everything that we need to be prepared. You know, I think about this idea of faith. There's a couple of ways in which this is used in the New Testament. You have the idea of like a system of faith, and then there's that my personal faith, my personal faith and belief system. And so when we look at this in Hebrews chapter 9, verses 26 through 28, it says something similar to what we've already seen. It says, "For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." Sometimes when we look at this, we have a promise from God that Christ is going to come back and he's going to take us with him as long as we have been obedient, right? But we look at the idea here that you know, salvation has come and we are in need, of course, of following the scriptures to that end. But Jesus, he is going to come again. And he is going to take us with him if we're still alive. But all we need to do is we need to follow him. Now, how in the world do we do that? Well, we need to follow the Bible. When you look at the Bible, when you look at and compare it to what denominations think about this, the Bible is not a revelation. It is the revelation of God's will. So last but not least, we've talked about this. We've talked about how we just need the Bible. Well, the Bible is our only really authority in religious matters. We need it. You can't say, well, you know what, I've got continuing revelation. You know, that's what a lot of these religious groups like to do. I've got continuing revelation, and that's what we're governed by. You have such as the Mormon Church. They will oftentimes have these new prophecies, so called, come about, and they will say new things. You know what? Some of those prophecies contradict things that they've already said, right? And that's how you know it's not from God, because God said it once and for all, and it's done, and yet they have to continually change their tune because, you know, they're not following the Scriptures. The Scriptures have all authority. God has given us everything. And if God gave us everything, then we need to look to it as authority. In Matthew 28 and verse 18, of course, Jesus said, "All authority hath been given unto me in heaven and in earth." In John 17 and verse 17, it says, "Sanctify them by thy truth, thy word is truth." And Jesus is referenced as the word. And in John 8 and verse 32, it says, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." The only way that we can be free is if we follow this word. You know, sometimes people look at the Bible as kind of a shackle. You know, that, look, we follow it, but man, it just hinders us from having so much fun. But that's not the case. The Bible is there to keep us in line so that we can be saved in the end. Now, I don't know of anybody that if they fell off of a big ship, let's just say they're on a cruise ship, they fell off the ship and someone threw out that lifeline to them, they threw out that little life preserver and they put it on and they're sitting there in the water and they think, you know what? This thing is so restricting. It's got me tethered to that boat over there. You know what? I don't like this. I'm just gonna let go of it. I don't like this thing. This is terrible. No. What happens in a situation like that? They don't want to be lost. They don't want to die. And so what are they going to do? They're going to hold on for dear life. And that's what we ought to do with the Scriptures. Hold on for dear life spiritually. And so as we round out our thoughts, let's think about this. If you have not yet become a Christian, you need to understand that the only way to go is the way that the Scriptures teach. And the Scriptures teach what we reference as the plan of salvation. And the first thing is done today is we've heard the Word of God, Romans 10 and verse 17, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." And so we hear and we must believe, John 3 and verse 16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." We hear, believe, and we must repent. Luke 13, 3, "I tell you nay, but unless you repent, you shall all likewise perish." So hear, believe, repent, and confess. Matthew 10, 32 and 33. Something we do every day of our lives. But of course, when we look at Acts chapter 8, we see that was also done by the Ethiopian eunuch at the point of baptism. And so we hear, believe, repent, confess, and we must be baptized. 1 Peter 3, 21, "The like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of good conscience toward God." And lastly, we must live faithfully. That's for every one of us that has already done those first five things. We must live faithful unto death. Revelation 2 and verse 10, "Be thou faithful unto death, and thou shalt receive a crown of life." If you are in need, respond to the invitation this morning. Please come as we stand, as we sing.